ね、
買って、はいはいはい。Hello, what's up?
Hi. How are you?
Good, good. How's it going?
Yeah, it is going good too. So today in our show we have Adit AK, so who is an artist and he has been performing in different stages and then he is upscaling in his thing, whatever he does actually. I'm so happy and honored to have you in the show, man.
So happy to be here, so happy.
Yeah.
Thank you for doing something like this.
Thanks a lot. Thanks
I think it's a great initiative and thank you for doing something like this. Yeah.
Thank you for coming up and putting out your story here.
Anytime.
Okay. First of all, to introduce Adit, he, as I said before, he has done a lot of theaters and then he has been an artist full time right now and he's volunteering for many good causes and he has changed and transformed a lot of people's life, I would say. As he starts to tell his story, you guys will understand what he is doing and it is something phenomenal and he has been already doing what I'm trying to do right now. I'm so happy about it, Adit, and keep doing and inspiring people as well.
Okay, anyway.
Like, I wanted to tell to people about this. So let's get into this, Adit.
Sure.
Like today I'm going to put up something different apart from what I have done before in all these six shows.
Okay.
So today I'm not going to ask you how it started and all those because your journey is totally different from others. So what's your goal in life, Adit?
Big question. Yes. I started off somewhere else, but if you ask me at this moment, I don't have a particular ambition or a particular goal. If I have to put it across as a goal, then I would say just keep learning as much as I can and keep creating as much as I can. That is my current goal.
Okay.
But I don't have a specific end place as to this is what I want to be or this is what I want to do. I am open to trying out everything that comes my way and exploring new things.
That's nice to hear. And then you told at this point of time that's your goal. So what was it when you were in childhood and then when you were in a teenage and all those? Can you just explain that a bit?
Growing up, I had a lot of things. Just like anyone else, as a child, you want to be everything that you see, anything that fancies. I wanted to be a sportsman at one point. I wanted to be a designer at some point. I wanted to be an actor at some point. I wanted to be a dancer at some point. I wanted to be... I wanted to do different things, but I think... trying out different things, I realized I just don't want to stick to one particular line of, like, one particular profession. So, I've been jumping around now.
I know. So, like, I personally came to know you when we were playing cricket alongside.
Yeah.
We had a good time. I remember you, like, from a childhood, I would say. Yeah. And then, like, we had a break and then I met you at the college. Joined in the college where I was studying and then it was a little bit surprised and now you have gone to a different level and you have started to do a lot of things. So that's nice. Like our journey also has come up in whatever you thought like you wanted to pursue your career in. That's nice to hear from you. So you already told there isn't any goal. So what is your dreams kind of thing? Maybe it might be a fascinating thing or else like something you wanted, a dream kind of thing that you wanted to do.
Again, dreams are along the same lines. I have been dabbling with a lot of things. So my dream is to do a lot of theater, probably jump into do films at some point and maybe get into... I've been working on a lot of educational projects, so I've been working on integrating arts into education. That has been one of my core work along the lines of education. So I would say my one of my dreams would be to get art integrated into education as much as possible. That would be along the lines of education and along the lines of creation. I think there's no end to it. I want to do everything possible. I know we don't have enough time, but I want to do everything possible.
I wish your dreams come true. You should explore a lot of things that you wanted to do in life. Fine.
Thanks. Yeah. Fine. Yeah.
Okay. What do you do right now, Vadit? Like not right now in the sense exactly right now.
Uh-huh.
To sustain and then to lead a career. Like, what are you doing?
Okay. So this is I don't have, like I said, I don't have one particular profession. So I keep juggling between different professions, different lines of work. So currently I have been working from home on a few small projects, and I've been learning some things as well. And if you ask me, I would say currently I've been working like freelancing for different educational companies to design some modules. Mm-hmm. And other than that, in the lockdown, I'm just eating and sleeping.
Like not exactly in the lockdown, like before the lockdown, like you were a theater artist, right?
Yeah. So right before the lockdown, so until last year, around this time, I was in a place called the Hummingbird School in the northeast of India, in a place called Majuli. I was working there at a school, and last year around end of May, I left that place to do some theater. So I've been doing theater from then. I've been going to different places to do theater. So yeah, I've been doing performances outside, and I've been working on production work, direction assistant, not just performing on stage, but also doing a lot of backstage work as well. And any learning opportunity that comes my way, I've been like grabbing at it. So yeah, I've been going around and performing and helping out backstage and doing different things.
Okay. Actually, he's been humble here, I would say. Like, he has performed in big stages and all those, but he sounds like he has just started his career. So he's just being humble, guys. And then if you like watch fully, you will get to know what all he has done. And then another quick question, Ajit. So how did the journey of becoming an artist started? Because you are playing cricket and all those. So how this came into your space?
Okay. So, yes, I was very much keen on becoming a sportsman until a long time. But at some point in life, I realized I'm not so competitive. I enjoyed letting other people win. It didn't really matter to me, and that didn't really help my sport career. So at one point, I slowly deviated from sports into the arts. And initially, I started off as a dancer, and I worked for different dance companies. I was an instructor, and then I gave auditions for different theater productions. I would go walk into different auditions.
Sorry to stop you here. Like, what was the start, like some spark which came, like, okay, let's start dancing. So when did that spark happen?
Okay. I didn't really know how to dance until a long time. So one of my cousin brothers, he put me into a dance class. He said, you will enjoy it. This was when I was in middle school. And I really enjoyed dance at that point, and I kept going back to these classes. But I had like a rule with my mom that it was like a challenge that if I passed my exams, then I could go for dance classes. So I passing exams were not an option. So I continued dancing for a while, and then of course I failed, and I had to stop dance classes. And then, but I was dancing. When I was in high school, I was dancing for different college teams. They used to give me, like, they used to make fake IDs and take me for competitions when I was in high school. So I was dancing for colleges when I was in high school. And when I finished high school, I was asking a friend of mine to put me in touch with somebody, some dance company, because I was getting really frustrated and I wanted to do something. And this friend of mine put me in touch with a dance school. And that was right after high school. And then I went and joined this dance school where I was learning and teaching simultaneously. And that's where it started. I didn't know what I was signing up for at that point. I definitely did not know. I didn't have an ambition saying, okay, this is what I have to do. But I enjoyed dancing, so I thought might as well learn it. So the learning journey started there, and the option was given by them that you can also teach simultaneously. And I think I got an interest towards teaching from there as well. So yeah, that's been fun. And from there, it took off.
Yeah, like some unexpected force pulls you into,
Whatever
like,
you want to do, yeah.
yeah, exactly. It's not
Absolutely.
planned or like you don't
Definitely
do
not
it
in my case.
purposefully. Okay.
No.
Not in many cases, I guess so. Like something happens and all of a sudden you're into a different profession. Okay, so let's take it a little bit light, and then like I'm going to show you a few photos right now, and then I want you to tell what was going through your mind at that point of time, and also like when was it and all those.
Sure.
Okay. I think one second, like I just got to look at my laptop.
This video is not out, and so many people have been asking me, when is your TED video coming out? It has not come out yet. This happened end of last year, December last year, and one fine day I get a mail saying, we are hosting a TED talk, and we think you fit in very well with the criteria, and we'd like you to come and give a talk. And now usually what I do is I just like keep deleting my mails, and I was like, huh, one such thing. Just so I just randomly clicked, and I was like, oh, okay. But I always have this thing of not really believing in what I do in a complete sense. So I said, okay, I was not sure if I was good enough to give a TED talk, if I like if I have experiences enough to give a TED talk. But
Okay.
I jumped at it anyway, and they wanted me to speak on education and arts in education, and yes, that's what I did. And it was really nice. This was at a college in a university in Pune,
Okay.
and they flew me down from Assam to give the speech, and I had fun.
Like
I don't know when the
I
video
think
comes
I
out, you will know.
am like I am one of those guys who are asking you when was the TED videos going to be
Yeah.
in YouTube or somewhere else to watch so that I get to know and learn a lot from you.
That was on arts and education. That talk was on arts and education.
Okay, so one second. Dikku Minien Lover, I'll come back to your question, but we will take forward with this session, and then I have a separate time for the questions. Okay, sorry for this, Dikku Minien Lover.
Oh.
Yeah.
It was a small shoot that we were doing. One of my very good friends, who's a dancer, him and I were doing a small shoot. We were doing a collaboration, and that was taken at that point. This was so this guy had choreographed a small piece for me for an audition, and that choreography was done about 7 years ago. And
Oh.
this choreography was just there, so we thought we might digitally shoot it, and then we decided to shoot it. And we were shooting it, so I was on a break from Assam. I had come down to Chennai, and the very next day I was leaving back to Assam, and we shot it. We shot this video all through the night, and just without sleeping, I went to the airport and I resumed my travel to Assam.
Actually, this is out on YouTube, right?
Yeah, this
is. I have watched it and then I just loved it.
Yeah.
Hope if others wanted to see, you can go to Adit's profile, or else you can go to YouTube, and then it is in some other media name, right?
Yeah, it, you can find it on my profile.
Yeah, that if you want to look at it, do go to this profile. And then your next photo is
okay.
Something very special to you, no?
Yeah, this place in itself is a very special place to me. So that part of the school where I'm standing on was built like an amphitheater. It's an open amphitheater. We built it on bamboos. And at that point, we were excited about that space because it had trees all around. So I used to take my children there to tell stories. So that was one such story that I was telling them.
You were doing some action, like some cricket or like, I don't know what did you do exactly.
It's a story. It's a very interesting story. It's one of the books that I love. And it's called Mukund and Riyas by Tulika Publishers. And it's a story on partition. Yeah, it's a story on the partition. And we were having a discussion on about the partition, about borders, about nationality and a lot of things. And this was with class 3 and class 4 kids. And it was one of the most special conversations and stories that I've ever had.
That's nice. Like people got to know from their small age, and then learning from you would have been a different experience for them. Like art and education together.
I have learned a lot from them. It's definitely a two-way process. I think I have learned a lot more from them than what I have taught them. So,
I would love to ask you what were your learnings in Hummingbird, but before that I have few photos and stuff.
Okay, that is a lot of color. This was again at the Hummingbird School. This was during Holi. The Hummingbird School had a very special way of celebrating things. And Holi is one such occasion where a lot of colors, and around that time it usually rains at Majuli. And so we were celebrating Holi, and it started raining, and the mud got really soggy. And at one point we started rolling on the mud, and like the mud also became colors, and we're just like splashing it on each other. So, and then it rained, we went to the river. So that was that. Yeah, it was a beautiful memory. I'd never forget the time I spent there. It's home.
Like, I hope you enjoyed a lot in Hummingbird. So
I did. I genuinely did.
Okay, so like, what is basically Hummingbird is, and where it is, and what do you exactly do there? Can you just elaborate it a bit?
Okay, so around mid 2017, I got in touch with a person here in Chennai. I was working on a dance video, and one of my friends put me in touch with someone who had worked in different places in the Northeast. And this person, you know, I like how I am usually. I just said, oh, this sounds really interesting. I'd like to experience this. You know, why don't you drop me their numbers? I'd like to get in touch with them. And she gave me like a few numbers. And I called each one of them. I said, you know, I can come and teach dance and theater for some time. You know, I have 6 months in hand, I can come. And all of them said they need academic teachers who can teach like maths or science. There was one guy who's the founder of the Hummingbird School. His name is Bipin Dane. The guy that he is, he's a brilliant guy. And he said, okay, you can come in to do whatever, just come see the place and see what works for you. And we'd love to have someone. And just make sure that whenever you plan to leave, that you train someone along the way who can take over what you're doing, sorts. So I decided I'll just go check the place out for about a week or 2 weeks. So I told him that I'll come there for, the school was brand new at that point. That's also something that really pulled me towards that place, because I'm not so comfortable working for established places and structured places. So this was like a brand new place and they were just building it. So I was even more excited to go there. So I told him I'll come down for 2 weeks and I'll come back the next year to join them. So I went with one backpack. It was close to a day and a half's travel. And when I reached there, I fell in love with the place. It was so beautiful and the people were so nice. I was still contemplating in my head as to what I was doing. It's in the middle of nowhere. As far as you can see, there is nothing around. It's like an empty space. So it was I got really excited, I think. I didn't know what I was thinking. I got really excited and I told them that, you know, I don't want to go back. I'll stay here. So I said, okay, I'm not going to go back and come back. You know, this is too far. So I'm just going to stay here and I'll probably stay here for 6 months or 1 year. And okay. That 6 months, 1 year, that just kept extending and extending and extending. I spent about 2.5 years there.
Oh my God. Yeah. Like 1 week's backpack has now changed into 2 years journey.
Yeah. And I still, for whoever knows me, they still know that the Hummingbird School is my home. And I keep going back there and it's a special place to me.
Okay, what does that school exactly does? Like you were a facilitator for art and education.
Okay, yeah, I forgot to answer your question on that. So the school started out like any other school. The school was for tribal children. So it started out as any other normal school. But I think the kind of people that came there there were people from different lines of, you know, different professions. The guy Bipin is from IIT Kharagpur. There was someone else called Dharamjeet who was from Azim Premji University, from the development background. There were different people from different backgrounds and they all brought in their speciality to that place. And at some point, that place grew into an alternative educational space for tribal children there. And so their learning experiences were completely, you know, made relevant to that place and their experiences. So they learned agriculture, they learned their own cultural and traditional skills like weaving, they played with bamboo to build things. This is how they learned mathematics, they learned science, you know, they were baking, they built an oven, they started baking. So it grew step by step into something so beautiful. And the people, all the teachers there are all local teachers. So they have the connect with the children there. And I think the school is, if any of you have a chance to visit that school, you must. And it's a beautiful school run by Bipin and his team. And my role there, I can't really say that I had a role there. I did whatever I could there. I was teaching at some point. I was also working on teacher training there. I was working on any construction work, I would go and help out. Any work in the field, I would go and help out. It's like your house. So you don't have a particular duty. In your house, you don't say, oh, I'll clean only the vessels. You do everything that is there to that house. So that is my house and I did any work that came in. I was managing finance at some point. I was managing, you know, people, the volunteers who came in from outside at some point. I was doing different things, but I think my main motive to go there was to integrate arts into education, which I did work on for a long time, but I also had many other duties.
That's nice to hear. People would have understand what Hummingbird is all about and if they get the chance, do go and visit hummingbird. And
Definitely.
Then like obviously if I had a teacher like you in my childhood, maybe I would
there
have
are
been a
many
new
many
person.
Many such brilliant teachers across the country. I would say there are so many people, so I would not take credit for this.
I'm just telling you, like someone, if I have found teaching maths in like the outdoors and stuff, it would have been a different game altogether.
Yeah, in that place you would want to be the part, you know, be a part of their learning journey. It was so beautiful, and you know, every single thing that happened in the school had so much attention given to, so much care given to. It was built out of a lot of passion by a lot of people with relevance to what their environment is. So it's really beautiful. If any of you, I say it again and again, if any of you have a chance, just pack your bag, go there, spend some time. It's a beautiful place.
And then like you were expressing yourself like a kid, I would say, like from the city here, you just went there. And then like at first for me, mountains was so hard to be in, but
yeah,
like I don't know what place you were exactly in, but you were like so fascinated.
It's an island, yeah.
Okay, so it's an island, and you are like so excited to go, and then it is so isolated, and I think you will like the ambience and the overall energy and environment of the
that's
place.
That's definitely you in relationships you call something a honeymoon phase, right? That was the beginning.
Yeah.
You know that, huh, okay, 1 or 2 weeks, oh, you're so excited. 1 or 2 months, you're still excited. Then few months down the line, you're like, oh, shit, what am I trapped into? Because, you know, you obviously, you've grown up in a city. You have a certain, you know, wirings to your system. You need a certain comfort and all of that. And this place broke every single structure that I had built up to the ground. Some point you have like very basic things there. The food is very basic. The living place is very basic. There is flood 3 months in a year. And when there's flood, there's water all around. So it really tests you. It's not such an easy place to live. I would definitely not say it's an easy place to live. But I think at some point, for the sheer joy of learning from that place, I just kept going with it.
So what were your learnings exactly from Hummingbird, apart from you taught them? What did you get back from them? What do you think you got back from them?
I got a family from there. I think every single person that I interacted with through that space was, it was a magical journey for me, right from the children to the old people, to different people who came in there, to the family that I had there, my colleagues. Each of them just, I would say I was like a zero when I went there. And these people gave me those experiences that kept building me at some point. And there were so many learnings, man. I don't know. It was like a...
Maybe if you want to put it up in words, maybe, and then tell a few things that you learned, I think it would be nice for people to see.
Okay. One thing that I definitely learned was I didn't know a lot about mental health and how it affected you and all of that. Living in that place, I think I tested my physical and my mental ability to a point where I almost, you know, I broke down. There were points where I lost about 15 kgs. I was anemic because I didn't get enough nutrition. And when I was lost physically, my, you know, I think all these tests changed me as a person in a lot of ways. And another thing that I would say is the kind of people that I met. it's I give all the credits to the people, because there were so many different kinds of people that I met from different backgrounds, and they changed my perspective on a lot of things.
Yeah, it was a life-changing experience of yours, I feel so.
Definitely, yes.
Okay, so let's move a little bit light and then... I think you are the judge for that show, is it?
Yeah, I was...
MOP Vaishnava, you are the judge.
Yeah.
Good and a nice feeling, I would say.
Yeah, I was a judge for a dance competition at MOP, and this was a guest performance that I had to do. Yeah, it was fun.
Obviously, you would have robbed.
Yeah, it was fun. It was good fun.
One second.
Yeah. Ooh.
Some rage in your face.
There was a theater show that I did with the Little Theater Trust in Chennai. They have these shows annually. It's called the Christmas Pantomime. And this show was on Star Wars. And they take up really famous productions and they make a musical slapstick comedy out of it, where there are different characters coming in from different productions, and it's like a festival in Chennai, and the little theater was the first platform that I stepped into when I started doing theater, and this was one of my, you know, I think it was my 7th or 8th show with them. Oh, and nice. Yeah. This was, I played the character Darth Maul from Star Wars. I was playing a villain for the show. So I had like paint all over my body. And that was about a lot of makeup work for that one.
Yeah. I hope you enjoyed performing.
I absolutely love performing.
So like, I'm not a big fan, or I don't know about Star Wars, but people could relate, I guess. Obviously, the villain would have been an eye-catching role.
It was good fun. It was really nice. I think it was not anything. The pantomime is nothing about Star Wars. So the storyline is completely different. You just you build off these characters, and it's an improvised show, more or less, where the characters build the script and then you play the show. It's a beautiful experience.
Super. Thanks for sharing your experience. And then like, you spoke about theaters and little, like, what did you
mean? Little Theater Trust.
Okay, the Little Theater Trust. Okay, so like, how do, if someone is interested to get into theaters and learn acting a bit, and then like, does theater supports, and how do one get into theaters?
So if I don't know, you have different ways to get in. You can audition.
Like, I want you to put all those ways and tell people like a career path or else a guidance that could help people out, and then they to start off their journey.
Yeah, definitely. So yes, there are a lot of auditions that happen. People constantly keep picking new faces out there, so you keep going to these auditions, and the audition is also a learning process where you keep failing, you know, because as a beginner you won't know anything. You're still, you know, at the learning process. You're still trying something new, so you shouldn't be scared of jumping in and trying out and, you know, being stupid, being weird. That's something that you have to get over, you know, being stupid or being doing something, you know, that you're not comfortable with. All these things you will have to break if you have to come into theater, and any skill that you have, you can bring into the space. So there are auditions that happens across the city, and you have Facebook groups, you have like You have posters coming out. You find it
like,
everywhere.
Can you tell me any through like Facebook groups for people to join?
There's a group called Theater Chennai, which has like they all the theater circuit from the Chennai city. They go there. They post about their auditions or their shows, and each of the production companies in Chennai also have their own pages, and they all put out auditions or shows that they do. So I would say if you have to get into theater first, go start watching some shows. And if there are workshops, go and attend workshops. There are so many workshops happening. So go attend some workshops, get comfortable, you know, making mistakes, being stupid, and then start giving auditions. And, you know, as a process,
then
you will
things
get there
happen
eventually.
Slowly.
Yeah.
So you also conduct auditions
I don't run a theater group. I freelance. I work for different companies, but I don't run my own theater group. So I don't keep any auditions as such.
Okay, not auditions, like workshops.
So I do conduct a lot of workshops, and these workshops are specifically request based.
Okay.
So if there is a specific request from somebody, then I conduct these workshops. I have enough things in hand, so I don't take up a lot of workshops. So if somebody is requesting, saying, okay, listen, Adit, we are doing this and we'd like you to take a workshop here, then I would go and take these workshops. But I myself don't really take a lot of workshops.
Okay. So like, how do one prepare back home to perform in the auditions? Like, what homework should they do, you think, personally?
The homework is a lot of mental work. It's just you should be ready to fail. That's all. Nothing else. Then when you go in, you're like, okay, it doesn't matter. You get it or don't get it. You should be ready to go and have fun. Because when you're under the pressure of, okay, I should crack this, then you're still under some pressure, right? So you should be ready to, like, you know, fail. You should be ready to be stupid. You should not be so cautious about your image or how you look like, what will other people think. All of that
exactly.
Break. That it's a lot of mental work than learning skills. Yes, the skills add up a lot. That gives you the confidence. Do whatever.
Yeah, exactly.
So you just keep preparing on, you know, there's so much content out there, man. On YouTube, people are taking workshops, and even outside, there are so many people taking workshops. There are places like Gothi Institute and like other places where there are constantly something or the other happening. And when if you look at theater as something that is just, you know, being on stage and performing, then you are going to struggle a bit. It's a package. So you have to be part of the experience to, you know, get an idea of what it is and how it works. So even if some company is opening out something where people can come and help out backstage, people can come and do production work, just jump in, be a part of the process, network with people, and then you will automatically find your way in.
Yeah,
I think
totally
that is one of the best ways to get in.
You just summarized it perfectly, I would say. So these are the things which like make people not to be a part of. If, for example, fear of failure, like fear of judgment, and like how do I handle this, how people see me, all these like takes one step back from like just go for it and then smash it. Like, you learn from your mistakes and then you like, you do what you started love to do. So how did you overcome the fear of failure? So that's the big subject, I would say. Like, in mind, when you prepare mentally as well, you would have skipped all the topic, like, okay, let's do this. But fear of failure is something which like breaks your heart. And then like, it's so hard to overcome. So how did you prepare yourself for it?
I didn't really prepare myself. I went out there, I failed. I broke my heart, I broke my confidence, and then And then
it would have been a hard process for you, no? Like
it is. It's definitely a hard process, and I think some people have it easier than the others. I did go out for a lot of auditions. I did like fail in a lot of auditions, and it broke my confidence. Thinking, okay, are you good enough? Are you like, you know? But once you enter the space, even like once you enter the space, you realize that it's not about you can acquire these skills at any point, but it's about just going and, you know, being free and not think too much about what other people might think. I think it's a process. It doesn't happen. So it's not a one step thing that, okay, you go in and, oh, okay, I'm forgetting what everybody is going to think about me right now. It doesn't happen like that. But at some point when you're really enjoying yourself, you switch this off and things fall
into place yourself automatically. And then like it just flows like a river, I would say.
Yeah,
that's how things happen. So another photo.
this was a photo shoot for a show. The show was called Garage Gang.
Okay.
And this was a pre photo shoot for the show, and we were just playing around with props. We had like a headlight, and we had a cap and the pom poms. Just playing around with that and took a shot. So this was it's for a show again.
Actually, it's a nice photo, I would say. Like when I was going through yours, I just liked it. It showed who you are as a person.
Yeah, I think each of the characters were coming out from that photo shoot of what the characters we were playing, and a little bit about ourselves also.
That's nice. And then the next photo,
ooh.
Adit is here, right?
Yeah, yes, okay. That's me. Okay, so this was May last year, and this was in a place called Tezpur in Assam. So this was the first time I had created a production, a theatre production with the children. And I had taken them outside to perform. That's the first time they're ever coming out of their place, their island. It's the first time they're entering an auditorium like that.
They were all nervous.
Exactly. If you see the picture, they'll all be sitting like this in a very uncomfortable position. But they're all like really uncomfortable. This was the first time they're going to hit the stage. And for this was a musical production where the kids themselves played the instruments, they sang, they danced, and they told stories. So this was one of my best experiences I've had. The joy I had creating this was just, I definitely got a lot of help from the local people, and there was also another person there called Mosam on the left, on the right corner, who came in as a volunteer. She also helped a lot with the entire process. And I think in theatre, it's never a single man show. There's so much that,
exactly,
you know, it's a collaborative process, and you need everybody to be in sync to create something. And this was the children just, they had, this was more like a festival, and we had a small portion in that festival. And when these children performed, the audience were in awe as to how children from a particular background in such a, you know, isolated place come out and do something like this. So they were so surprised, and this was such a heartwarming moment for me. Before the show, they were all, you know, tense and scared, and they couldn't get even one rehearsal, you know, properly. And then when they got on stage, they performed like stars. They were so good. It made me so happy. This is such a beautiful experience.
Exactly. I totally can get how you would have felt at that point of time. it was good and nice to hear, and you made people to perform and come out of their shell and experience something they have never experienced before.
That's why I'm for making on this.
Thanks for making their life colorful, I would say, and experience a lot of things.
Somebody else did it for me, I'm doing it for someone else.
That's nice. But this one, I think... once again, guys. Actually, there were a lot of photos where Adit was like focused, and then like he is in the picture, in the like a center of attraction kind of thing. But I left all those, and then like there was a lot of photos, and then I chose this because he's dancing and he's enjoying it. But yeah, now to you, Adit, explain the photo.
Okay, this that picture is not anywhere on social media. It is a picture that was taken in Africa. I had gone there for a design summit, and this was at a refugee camp where there were refugees from South Sudan and Congo Republic and all these war affected areas. And this was in Uganda.
Okay.
And we spent a lot of time at the refugee camp. I was there in Uganda for about a month. And again, this was another eye-opening experience for me in terms of a lot of things. I can just keep going. So this picture particularly is where we were dancing with the community's children. They were putting up a show, and then after the show, we were dancing with them, and they had like drums, and like they had like the thing made out of like coconut
their
leaves.
Own tradition.
Yeah, their own tradition.
Exactly.
Yeah, and it's like so this dance was like a kut dance.
we went in there. Dance and
yeah, so we went in and we had crazy fun. But yes, Uganda was something that changed my perspective on a lot of things. I met people from different parts of the country, people from war affected zones, conflict zones, people who have gone through trauma that you cannot even imagine in a lifetime, with such traumatic experiences, there were also other people who came in from different backgrounds, and it was a culturally different place, and the entire vibe of what this experience gave me was something, when you put together a bunch of people, even let's say 4 or 5 people from different backgrounds, there's usually like a clash. There's like, oh, I'm better than you, or I have more experience. But this was a place where there were children, there were like 5-year-old children to 60-year-old people from different countries, from different cultural backgrounds, from different social economic backgrounds. And we all gelled like one family, and it was an out of the world experience for me. This was something else.
That's nice. You enjoyed Uganda a lot and help people out there. And then I wanted to go to another session right now. It is rapid fire. I just want you to answer in one word, and let's see how it goes. So performing or teaching?
Both.
Sorry, I want you to go with one. And I want you to put in tough spot. Okay, thanks. Teaching. Successful life or happy life?
Happy life any day.
Whom you love or the person who loves you? Whom you love or the person who loves you?
Okay, my definition of love is somewhere else. Okay. So I can't choose this.
Yeah, I get it. Yeah. Totally get it. Traveling or staying at home?
Definitely not. It depends on what is home. I have different homes.
Okay. Well put up.
Traveling.
You travel and there's already...
But I'm not a traveler as such. I don't save up money to go travel, spend some holiday. My travel is like, somebody is calling me for work there. Let me go there. That is my travel.
Okay.
Otherwise, I don't save up money to do extravagant travel as such.
Yeah, I get it. And hope the audience also get it, not alone me. Like, traveling or staying home is like, I'm asking whether you would love to go to places empty or else like you wanted to be at
I make every place that I stay my home.
It's your home.
So,
okay.
And I've been...
Right. Okay. So, wherever you travel, that like you
That's
make it
home.
As your
yeah.
home.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Well put up. Bike rides or car rides? Which one
bike.
Do you prefer? Okay. Fly, crawl or underwater?
Fly, crawl or underwater. I think I'm very scared of water.
Okay. On a scale of 1 to 10, how much would you rate your journey till date?
On what basis? Like my journey on what basis?
Like satisfaction towards life.
I don't think we can ever be satisfied, so I'll give it like an 8.
Okay. Yeah, obviously we don't get satisfied. Just wanted to know your mindset of
I wouldn't change anything. I think I have beautiful experiences, so I don't know why I gave.
Maybe we'll rate 8.59. you can also change it right now. You have one opportunity.
10.
Okay. Don't spare enough. And then like quick questions also. So like you have like when people hear your story, it's totally different on like the general aspects of like how do they lead their life and working in a 9-to-5 basically. So like how are your parents like are they helpful or like how did this or else did it change in one point of time? How did all this happen?
They kept changing at every point of time. I think initially they were not the most supportive kinds.
Okay.
And at every point, I think my parents have also had their own journey with me. Because these are things that, you know, you don't see in a community like
yes,
this.
Yes, yes.
So... They are also getting used to me. Initially, when I was dancing, they are like, why are you outside the home after 8 o'clock? I'm like, So, it started from there. You know, you have to be back at this time and you have to do... And every layer by layer, it kept changing. I think I'm not a rebel. I don't fight with my parents. I think that has helped me a lot in making them understand what my journey was. So, I don't really fight with my parents. And whatever they say,
yeah,
I'd hear them out completely. I sit and hear them out and I still do whatever I want to do anyway. and I also prepare
it, it
them.
It is actually a different kind of rebel, I guess. Like you don't want to create a chaos, but at the end you are going to do what you wanted to do. That's
Absolutely.
A nice way to actually overcome choosing a profession like this or like you just want to do what you want to do kind of thing. And then moving on to the next question, who guides you on your journey?
On what journey?
Like
life. So this is okay. Whatever I'm doing is something that is borrowed from different places. So I can't say there's one particular person that is who's there that I'm following the path of. So I've had some brilliant teachers, amazing mentors out there who definitely, you know, put me in the right path every once in a while, made me realize.
You wanted to thank specific people you want to thank, because I know you have a lot of people to thank, but someone who has played a special part in you personally and then professionally as well, and like helping you out when you are down or something.
No, I don't think I can give one person this space. I think I've had a lot of people, and if I start naming them, I'm going to forget one or two here, and which is unfair.
So, exactly.
To start off with, my parents and my friends for sure, friends from school. And a couple of my friends from college, and then my dance teachers, all my dance teachers, all my mentors from theater, all my mentors from the educational background, and the people that I've worked with, all of them were my teachers. All my colleagues were my teachers as well. So yeah, all of them. That's nice. I'm not like, going to name.
Okay, yeah, it sounds fair enough. You have learned from a lot of people and you want to thank all them. Yeah. It's so nice of you, like you never forget them since from your childhood. Like you just told your school friends as well. That's nice.
Yeah, they've been there. Yeah.
So another question. People have asked you questions to ask you, so I am just time is running out and I want to put some good questions to you. Okay, places you have traveled generally, like from India and also abroad, and like what have you impacted in their community? Like what do you feel you have impacted in their community and helped them out?
I don't know about helping community. Any place that you go to, you have an impact there and they have an impact on you. So there is no specific motive of, you know, it's a give and take journey. Anywhere you go, I think, and for any reason that you go, you have an impact and they have an impact on you. I have not traveled a lot. Wherever work has taken me, I've traveled. And that's mostly south of India, inside Tamil Nadu, small villages and small towns in Tamil Nadu. And in Kerala, I was teaching dance for a while in Cochin. Then in Karnataka, I've been to small towns, and also in Bangalore, in Hyderabad, and in Andhra Pradesh, I've gone to a few places. In Maharashtra, I've worked in a few places, and in Assam, of course, in different parts of Assam, and other than that, Delhi, and around Delhi, and I've gone to, I don't think I can pull out everything, but I'll just say wherever, and I've gone to Malaysia for a show, for a theatre show, and Uganda. For Africa, for the design summit.
Okay.
Yeah, pretty much that.
Yeah, like you have worked
It's not a lot. I have not traveled in a way where, like a holiday or something. I have not traveled. I haven't really had holidays where I went and, you know, just chilled or whatever. All my travel was some or the other, like work-based travel. Wherever.
Actually, I think that's something like you will be very focused towards, like you have a work to do, so you are there, you have a if you have spare time, you enjoy a lot, like hang out, have food, and then so this is how a travel journey actually completes, I would say, like apart
Works for me.
I also would love to travel like this, but right now I travel like a free-spirited soul. I just do things what I like. I just be wherever I want to. I sleep wherever. That's how my travel is. Maybe in the future, I get to work on few projects like you. And then like some project comes up, I would be happy to channelize it that way.
Absolutely. So it's fun. It's nice. Yeah.
Yeah, it's totally fun. And then thanks a lot, Adit, for sharing your stories. Absolutely. And then telling your the true side of you, like you didn't hide anything, like you just put it up, like how you dealt your life with, you didn't put some sausages up and then started to tell, create stories just to impact people. You just spoke what your heart said to. And I hope this story, like your story would have, like we had 2 minutes time, but still it got disconnected. I'm sorry about it.
We've spoken past an hour. Wow.
Yeah. Like, I never felt like it was an hour.
Thanks.
Like, I would just keep hearing your stories for hours together, I guess. I just loved it. The experience you have had, and then the way you explained them, and how connected you are to whatever you do, it just shows in your face. It
shows in my face.
Yes. Like, you're so expressive. Obviously, you are a theater. Like, you do theaters. You are an artist. like obviously it shows in your face, and thanks for your time.
Yeah,
and
absolutely,
thanks for
absolutely,
joining
man.
This. I'm so happy.
And
to
I think
have
Karthik, you should also put out your story at some point and let someone else interview you. Dude,
I don't.
You should do that as a finale for your entire series. You know, get someone to interview you and talk about
maybe
your
you
journey
should,
as well.
Maybe I think you would be the right fit for
I'm
this.
I'm a bad interviewer.
If you okay, let I'll
but
try
do,
to
do,
figure
do
out
keep
something
in mind and do something where you can also tell people about your journey. You've spoken to so many people about their journey, and I think you've had quite an interesting journey as well, doing a lot of crazy things, adventurous things. So do put it out there. I'd definitely love to hear about that as well.
Yeah, thanks a lot. Thanks a lot, man. Like it gives like little bit motivation to me, like something what I'm doing as like okay, someone has recognized me for what I'm doing. That's a happy feeling, I would say. So, like you put it across, I'm so happy about it.
Good.
Thanks
absolutely
a lot, and then thanks a lot for your time. That's so precious. And then keep inspiring people, and then like you should do a lot of things what you like to do, and then like the hummingbird, you have transformed people's life, and then I hope you also transform a lot of people's life in the future as well, and keep doing what you do. Thanks
absolutely
a lot.
Thanks much, and thank you for having me.
Thank you.
Good
thank
night.
You. Thank you, Anta. Bye bye, good night.